Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Ask Mr. Boswell if he will have our invocation, please.
Let's bow our heads, please.
Most gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for all the blessings you have given us. Thank you for the great country we live in. Dear God, we'll be with the Lashleys tonight as Brother Bill here is in hospital, and look after him and help him heal him and get him back. God, just be with them and comfort them and put your hand upon them. And dear God, help us tonight to make the wise decisions for our county as we go about the county's business. These things we ask in thy name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, I'm going to start with public comments, and I do want to remind you that you have 3 minutes, and you will be timed. Sherry is our official timer on this, Sherry Cook, so please limit your comments to 3 minutes. First one is Karen Al Chakar. Did I say that right? Did I get that right? I'm close.
I'm shocked. If you got it right, we would have been a little surprised, actually. I've talked to most of you individually, but I've never actually made a public comment in front of you about the Alamance Orange County line, and I wanted to do that so it would be on the public record. Our family moved, well, actually, my husband and I and one baby moved to Alamance County in 1984. We bought our first home and had no idea there was a dispute about the county line. Lawyer, the register of deeds, realtor, everybody. We're in Alamance County. Life is good. And we didn't know that there was going to be an issue several years down the road. So we immediately became part of Alamance County. We began to increase the population of Alamance County. We now have 4 sons that are almost all adults now. And we've done it. We are Alamance County. We go to church in Alamance County. Our family, both of us have family in Alamance County. The kids were on recreation leagues in Alamance County. They were born in Alamance County. They go to library in Alamance County. When my husband got his citizenship to the United States, I think we were in the Alamance news. I mean, it was big time. So I've been a part of the Alamance County school system for 18 years. And that's where we live, and that's where we exist. The biggest thing we do in Alamance County, I think the thing that's, I'm worried a little about the taxes, but the thing that bothers me the most is that if we have to move to Orange County, we have to vote there. And we don't know anything about the people in Orange County, the people there. I look around this room, I know every one of you by name, I know you by reputation. I look around this room and I know a lot of these people, and that's not the case if we were to be involved in Orange County. And we're like a voting block because there's 6 of us, and we want to know the people for whom we are voting. So we want to be able to vote with confidence. And because we know people here, when somebody comes up for office, if we don't know them personally, we probably know their wife's, you know, second cousin 4 times removed or something, and we can find out about them and be able to make an informed decision. I was sitting here and I'm looking at the seal. It says pro bono publico, which I'm probably murdering the Latin. But that means for the good of the public, if I'm not mistaken. Government is supposed to be for us. We put you in office to do the right thing by us, and we're asking you to do the right thing by us. Leave us where we signed up to be, and that's in Alamance County, because we really do like you.
We like you too. Hope to keep you. Thank you, Tom. Next is Sue Dayton. You're not going to read all those papers.
Oh, no. I'm going to leave with you for later. Anyhow.
You'll save something.
Yes, I'll save for later. Good evening, all of you. And my name is Sue Dayton, and I've talked to y'all before. You know that. I moved to Alamance County about 3 years ago. I'm a resident. I have an antique shop in Saxbaha, and I also work full-time, as most of you know, for an environmental group. And I'm here to talk to you tonight about a resolution that was adopted by the Mecklenburg County Commissioners in April. And that resolution is going to be submitted to the state. And Mecklenburg County Board of Commissioners is asking that the state require all medical waste incinerators in the state of North Carolina to come into compliance with the new and more protective EPA standards for air pollutants by 2012 instead of 2014. And this is big. The Mecklenburg County Commissioners realize that incineration, even though incinerators are permitted and state approved. They receive a permit from the state, and they and under that permit, they have to use air pollution control equipment. The equipment does not stop all of the air pollutants from being released into the air. So what I've assembled for you tonight is a few pieces of paper, a background on Stericycle, with some data about the types of air pollutants that are emitted and what type of health risk it poses to our residents, particularly to children and pregnant women, elderly, and people with, you know, asthma and other respiratory problems. I also included a copy of the resolution as it's being submitted to the Orange County Commissioners. They're voting on it tomorrow night. Tonight, Chatham County is voting on the resolution, and it will be heard by Chapel Hill City Council and Carrboro and probably some other town and city council folks as well. I wanted to share with you one other thing here. And I just have one copy of this, but this was an article that appeared in the Mecklenburg, actually it was a Charlotte News and Observer. And there is a man named Bill Petrakis, and he is one of the regulators for the state on medical waste. And this is a statement he made. In quotes, "The truth of the matter is that 90 to 95% of the waste that goes to an incinerator doesn't need to go there," said Bill Petrakis, an NC Division of Waste Management official who interprets the state's medical waste rules. I wanted you to see that, because although you as our county commissioners cannot do anything about the rules, the state can adopt rules stricter than the EPA. And there are alternatives, state-approved alternatives to incineration medical waste, and Stericycle has them. So I'll leave this with you. Thank you.
I'd like to ask a question of her, if you don't mind.
You sure can.
Thank you. Does Graham have to approve their anything in their process at all? Isn't it in the city of Graham?
Yes, it is. Yes.
Is it the city? Mm-hmm. Or have you approached the city?
Not yet. Actually, I was too late to get on their council agenda.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just knew it was in her city limits.
Yeah.
If I'm not mistaken.
But I'm going to try to get on it for next month and let them know about this. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Nice to see you all.
Next is Heather
Bjork. She is with Hawaii and Scandinavian.
Thanks. My name is Heather Bjork. I'm a Burlington resident for 14 years. I'm a mother of two young children, aged 9 and 6. I'm also a teacher. I work with children through art education, through Abracadoodle, Remarkable Art. I also work with children in our church, and also I'm active with our children in their schools. And the reason I'm here tonight is to speak on behalf of the concern about the well-being of children and their health. I became actually active against some of the about Stericycle's concerns and the type of pollutions that they are emitting through their medical waste incineration several years ago. Had actually gone to Chicago to speak at their annual shareholders meeting. And the concerns are is that with Stericycle being the largest medical waste treatment in the country, it has two huge incinerators in Haw River. It's burning 26.3 million pounds of medical waste in 2008-2009, which equals 178 pounds a year per person for every person in Alamance County, which basically works out to half a pound a person per day. And medical waste incinerators release tens of thousands of toxins. These are toxic air pollutants that include things like mercury, dioxins, furans, particulates, lead, sulfur dioxide, nitrogen oxides, several other toxic byproducts. All of these, which are linked to several types of problems, including cancer, brain damage, birth defects, learning disabilities, asthma, liver and kidney damage, heart problems, and many other illnesses. And my concern is if you think about the kind of pollution and what it would do to just an average adult, think about what that same type of concentration of pollution would be in a small child or in the fetus of a pregnant woman. And I'm very concerned about it because of the fact that there are other alternatives to medical waste incineration. Stericycle does have an autoclave, which is another type of non-incineration waste disposal in Concord that's operating at only a third of its capacity, so more of the waste could easily be shipped there. They are also in a very aggressive effort to get in under the more lax standards that are currently in place for environmental release of toxins into the air. And so that's another concern as well. I would invite anybody that has concerns about it as well to be a part of the public hearing on this topic next Tuesday, which will be May 25th at 6 p.m. at Alamance Community College in the auditorium. So I do feel very strongly based on the fact that Stericycle has had countless violations. They have had mercury levels that were close to 30 times higher than the new EPA standards through their stack test. They've also had lead levels that were 8.3 times higher than the new standards from previous stack test. And that I would encourage you to support the Mecklenburg County resolution. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, Ann Robbins.
Thank you and good evening, Madam Chairperson and Commissioners. Well, here we are again after 2 years of hard work, all assembled here tonight. I want to thank all of you for everything that you have done for the North 9th Street neighborhood and hope that you will continue to make things happen in our favor, to be in Alamance County forever. Just want to say the ones that have helped us is the ones that we're going to keep in office. However, I want to thank Orange County for all their input, and they have really been for us to stay in Alamance County, where we've been paying our taxes and voting for the past 32 years. I have met some wonderful people from Orange County during this long, drawn-out event. As for Alamance County Commissioners, thank you for your support and all the time and input you have given us. Remember, we helped put you where you are today and have been voting for you, paying Alamance County taxes for the past 32 years. My only question to you is why, if you're having such a hard time making the budget work, would you want to give our tax dollars away? My advice to everyone is to keep all original documents, fight for what you believe in, and don't ever give up. Thanks to the many people that have called or come by to talk to me and offer their help, and especially to our Mebane City Council, Mayor, and Town Manager, and our strong North 9th Street neighborhood. Thank you.
Thank you. We hope it's going to work for us, too. Henry Vines?
Madam Chairman and Commissioners, I come tonight. I wanted to speak to you about the quarter cent sales tax that y'all had on the agenda for tonight. You know, on behalf of the Farm Bureau, we've worked with y'all, and this is something that we have wanted to look at as an alternative way of raising revenues for the county. As we stand right now, we are looking at a possible increase in property taxes this year, which is going to impact all property owners. We think that this 1/4 cent sales tax would be a fair way if we have to increase our revenues here in the county that would allow all citizens to help pay, you know, for this instead of putting the burden back on the property owners here in the county. I would urge you to put this referendum on the ballot. Let the people of this county decide whether or not they want this. This is not a decision that y'all are going to make, whether you're going to tax us or not. But the decision of raising our property taxes will be only y'all's. I do think that it is only fair to let the people of Alamance County decide how they would like to be taxed if they're taxed. And that's the reason that we have been standing for this sales tax for several years. This is nothing new that we have came up with. We've been after this thing for years to try to stop the increase in property taxes, which affects farmers tremendously. We'd appreciate your consideration.
Thank you.
I'd like to ask a question, please.
Yes, sir.
Did the Farm Bureau pass a resolution to this effect?
Our policy states that, you know, we support lower, you know, property taxes.
But did the Farm Bureau pass a resolution to this effect?
We don't have a resolution, no, sir.
Okay, well, you said you were speaking on behalf of them and that they were endorsing this.
This is something that we have, we have spoke.
Is it in a resolution or in resolution form? Or?
No, it's just something that the board has done.
Formally?
The county board, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, is it in minutes?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Mr. Sutton, they brought this to us when we were at
at their meeting.
At their meeting, at the library.
I wasn't at that meeting.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
And we
brought it
up. It's been brought, 5 years ago. We brought it up when we were facing the big tax increase of about 3 cents.
Was there a vote on it though?
In our
is your board?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. And it was in favor.
Yeah.
Okay. So I've been told otherwise, and I just want to make sure I get the facts.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Sorry if I do that too much.
Chandler Palethorpe, did I do that good?
Well, no, Tim's not bad.
I'm sorry you've gotten so you can pronounce it well. It means I've probably been here too much. I just wanted to thank y'all for considering us and for listening to what we had to say at previous meetings we've had, because I sure didn't feel like Guilford County had done that for us. And I pray and hope that y'all will prayerfully consider us in your county line voting. Guilford County said the line is what it is, but we know that it's not what it is if we got to the stage we are at now. We'd like to stay in Alamance County, and we'd like for the other people that want to stay in Alamance County to be able to stay in Alamance County too. So I guess my exhortation to you is to not just go along with Guilford County or think about deals that lawyers have worked out, but maybe get Mr. Albright to work on how to keep us. Thank you.
Thanks. He's working on it. Okay, Mr. Carrie Aldridge.
Thank you, Madam Chair. It's good to be back in this room after a number of years. As you all know, my name is All Red. And when you start talking about raising taxes, I get real red. Red in face and mad. When this county had revaluation 8 years ago, the tax rate should have been lowered to 38.5 cents to be revenue neutral. A revenue neutral rate is not what the Times News reporter misunderstands. The revenue neutral rate is the amount of money that would have been brought in prior to the year of revaluation, not just the previous year. You all understand that. The rate that was set at 43 cents.
42.
Well, it was higher than what the revenue neutral rate was.
42, though.
Pardon me, I'm pretty close.
Yeah.
Okay. Before the end of the revaluation period, the board had jacked the rate up to where it was before we ever had a revaluation. So they took all the windfall that they got out of new construction. They took all of the revenue that they got out of increasing the sales taxes, and they grew the county government by catering to special interest groups who want more taxpayers' money. And departments, special departments that want more taxpayers' money. People who said they didn't need any additional personnel have wound up increasing their departments by astronomical amounts. I do not defend Republicans. I do not defend Democrats. I've had a long career in politics. I am not here tonight to promote my political career. I think I've had about all the career I can stomach, as a matter of fact. But I don't want the taxpayers of the, I'm speaking for the taxpayers, because I think they have not got a voice down here. Somebody needs to be thinking about the taxpayers. And you need to tell the county manager what Dirty Harry said. Don't even think about it. cut it out wherever you've got to cut it out. And I can give you some silly little examples of stupid things that are being done, but I know my time's limited, so I'm going to close with this. Will Rogers said, "Thank God I'm not getting all the government I'm paying for." Because we've got too much, and you need to cut some of it out. And we don't need sheriff's deputies acting like highway patrolmen. And we don't need to pay somebody to go around and lock the gate on the county parks every night. Just put up a sign that says, park open from sunup till sundown, and let the sheriff's deputies patrol it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Brown. Next is Don Schaffner. Is she in the other? Oh, there you are, Don.
Yeah, I've been here before.
I'm Don Schaffner. I've resided in Guilford County for 30 years. And now I'm in Alamance County for 1 year. And I live on Cumming Street, so when I back out of my driveway, I'm backing out in Guilford County. So I would like for you to leave the line where it's at, because I like Alamance County over Guilford County. And I think if you do move the lines and stuff, I want to know who's going to pay to have the deeds of the lands redone, because see, my deed says I'm living in Alamance County, not Alamance Guilford. I mean, like, if I could sell my land, that's going to be, I'm going to have a hard time, because honestly, I would not buy a house that was in Guilford in Alamance. I'd go to one county. And that's, you know, that's the way it stands with me. And I know people in Alamance, and I like being in Alamance, and I'd rather stay in Alamance. Thank you.
I'm sorry, this question is coming up. As you go down your street off of Alamance Street, are you on the right or left?
Okay, from Alamance, I am on the...
Going down Cummings.
Going down Cummings. I'm at 609 Cummings Street.
Is that the right or the left? Just curious.
Coming down. Okay, I'll be on the left.
Okay, you're on the left.
I'm on the Alamance.
Coming from Alamance.
Because the line that I was showed comes right down the middle of the street.
It's a real wide street.
Right.
And you live on the, you said the right or left? I'm sorry.
Right.
On the right.
I mean left.
On the left.
Excuse me. You get me.
I'm which sorry. Way
I don't talk in front of people, so excuse me.
You did a good job. You did a good job.
And everything. I mean, you know, back out of my driveway, I'm in half Guilford and half Alamance.
Okay. I just want to know which side of the street you're on.
So, I mean, you know, I don't want to have to be split up, because I've got two lots there, and I didn't know it until tax time come last year. So, okay. I appreciate you leaving the line where it's at and everything. So, you know, like I said, the deeds, everybody would have to change their deeds to Alamance Guilford or Alamance Orange, whatever. I mean, you know, I'm on disability, and, you know, it's not but so much I can pay.
We understand.
So, I appreciate y'all listening to me.
Thank you. Thank you. That concludes our public comments.
Eddie's shoes on that.
I'm sorry, Eddie. Did I skip you? I saw
she did intentionally.
I did. Come on, Eddie. I'm sorry. I apologize.
Oh, you had to work that.
I promise you I did.
Give him a few more minutes and he'll stroke on out
of here. I've been worried about you for 2 months after I heard you had that seizure or whatever.
I don't know what I have.
I apologize.
Madam Chairman, when Clyde gets up here tonight, I want you to ask him a few things. The way I see it, the state can strike any section of this proposed bill they want. They can strike us, and then when they sign it, come back, y'all covered, we're stuck in Orange County, group to do. Sorry about that. Now, that's the way I see it. I read that bill, and that's the way I see it. For me to be a state rep, you're going to have to give me a whole lot of them chihuahuas before that I would vote for this thing that it's going to turn around and set precedent for every county that has a little problem. And they're not going to want to do it if they're in their right minds. I can't see it. There's already laws how to handle it. If we won't stay in Orange County, and you need to send something down there, survey the thing and send it as a line move. That is what the state house is for. I think Tim brought up one time about Richmond and Wake counties. Did they have to send get us a bill?
Wake and Franklin.
Wake and Franklin. They did, just like the law said. They took the thing to the respective courthouses. They signed off, sent it to the Secretary of State. All right. Apparently, we can't do that because the state don't know how to measure 200 foot, nevertheless, 227 mile lines. And so the other thing that we could do is resurvey it as a line move and then send it as a bill, and we know what we'll get. If you send it like this, I can see them sitting there, it's going to be too much trouble. It is in Orange County. So I won't tell you, you know how I feel about the whole mess, and I won't take no more of your time.
Thank you, Eddie. Okay, now that's all the public comments. I do want to say that we are going to pull the 0.25% sales tax tonight because Mr. Lashley is in the hospital, and he did ask me if I would pull this until the next meeting. And so we are going to pull that vote tonight and to discuss that. So it's off. We will move on now to Juvenile Crime Prevention Council and annual report from Mr. Steve Van Pelt.
Good evening. I've got on my JCPC hat tonight.
Okay.
Okay. We bring you good news and some challenges. This is our executive report to the county commissioners. And The Juvenile Crime Prevention Council, we are trying to reduce the incidence of juvenile crime. Or should I ask, do you have the executive summary in front of you?
Yes.
We sent it over by email today, and Steve Fischel, who is the chief at Juvenile Justice, has another report just hot off the press. I think this came in about
bigger than this one.
Oh, yeah. You can read that between now and the next meeting. That's the entire report that just came in about 3 o'clock this afternoon.
I believe it's still warm
and thanks to Steve, we've got that.
Hot off the press.
Do you want to give one to Mr. Honeycutt and give him, if you want to give him Mr. Lashley's also?
And Pat needs one as well.
Okay. What we've been trying to do, we try to reduce the incidence of juvenile crime. We try to reduce the incidence of gang-related crime and gang involvement. We try to increase school attendance and academic performance and increase parental involvement and subsequent accountability. We've been looking strongly at another sheet you've got here. It's the Alamance County 3-year comparison. If you'll look at that very top line, you will see at the end of fiscal year 2007, we had 1,069 complaints. And the next year we had 859. End of this past June, 654. Currently, we've had 504 complaints this year, and if you divide that by 10 and multiply it by 12, it's going to come out around 604. So that's going to give us unless something really strange happens between now and June the 30th, well, it looks like about another 10% drop. We feel like that we had a little bit to do with this. We think that there are several things that has contributed to this drop. One is the change in North Carolina law. that requires law enforcement officers to do certain things before they bring a juvenile complaint. But we also think there's a heightened awareness for school safety due to incidents like Columbine and Virginia Tech. We're seeing more after-school programs involving at-risk youth. That keeps the students possibly at school or at other places where they're supervised at the high crime times, which would be from the time school lets out until parents get home in the evenings. We also have more proactive JCPC-sponsored programs, such as the Teen Achiever Program, and we do have provided additional training for parents, child and family team intervention work, which has been an effort through social services, mental health, the schools. Our gang task force, JCPC has been able to secure a grant, and I couldn't find anywhere in my reading exactly how much money that was. Steve, do you remember what the grant is for? How many dollars? But anyway, we've started into that grant this year, and we're just about ready to roll with it. Our priorities for funding, you can see that at the bottom of the executive summary. We're still looking at interpersonal skill building and conflict resolution, community service, our Resolve program, structured activities such as after-school tutoring, and here are our challenges. We still need mentoring programs. There's a lot of mentoring programs in our community, in our schools, but we need more of the type where someone's got a buddy that can reach out and take a child by the hand and be a significant adult in their lives. We have been working hard on a structured day reporting center for students, and I'm going to talk a little bit more at length about that in just a moment. We also need a transition program for youth returning from to this community from youth development centers, wilderness camp, and other out-of-home placements. We are continuing to seek additional gang intervention prevention programs, and, of course, additional programs focused on the concern of Latino youth. We monitor and evaluate these programs as they come to us, and many of them we do fund. Our funding recommendations for this year are there in front of you. Most of the bulk of our money will go to the Alamance County Dispute Settlement Center, $214,000. The Teen Achiever Program, this is $49,000. $749. That's the Positive Youth Center located on Graham Hopedale Road. That's run by Kerry Richmond and his wife. The Found in Him Ministry, $10,000. And the Teen Outreach Program, which is a proactive program that we do in two of our middle schools, Graham Middle and Turntide Middle, $40,600. And we also set aside a small amount, $15,500, which we combine with some funds from mental health called non-UCR funds. We have a secretary that helps with JCPC work and with community collaborative work. And that's a total of $330,218. We haven't heard at this point whether that figure will be reduced. We haven't heard anything to say it would be reduced. It was reduced last year because of the state budget. On the third page of the executive report, the county commissioners in all counties are expected to provide some kind of county matching funds. Some are 20%, some are 30%, some are 40%. We're a 30% county match. Most of our match does come from in kind, and facilities for housing these programs are what is provided. The county commissioners do provide a small amount for psychological services, which is administered by the youth services program. one thing that we are looking at this year, we looked at it this year, is a structured day treatment program. Which was considered by us. We took a trip down to Randolph County and observed their operations. We asked a lot of questions, and we developed a timeline, and we worked closely with Craig Honeycutt and trying to find a location. As we all know, we're in a remodeling process, and we're using most of the space available. He was able to find a space, but after looking at that and looking at another consideration, which is might be some additional funding, we decided to put this off for a year. What we're going to do, and hopefully in 12 months, we'll some spaces will be freeing up where we can look at a more appropriate place to put the program. And secondly, we're going to explore some grants. At least that's what I've been told by Lisa Dotson with Dispute Settlement Center. She's the one that's taking and wanting to take the lead on this. A day reporting center could save us some money in the long run. Instead of having to take children that maybe get expelled from school or suspended from school and send them to the detention center in Durham or Greensboro, we'd be able to use this facility, and that would save us some costs there. Kids coming out of youth detention centers or youth development centers or wilderness camp or other places coming back in the community, this program could be used as a transition program.
Is that linked with the school system?
What is that, Tim?
That program that you're talking about.
No.
It's not at all?
No. We had one at Sellers Gum when I was principal there. We got a $500,000 grant for 2 years from the Governor's Crime Commission. And we put in some JCPC money and did that for 2 years. But that money ran out, and that program is no longer. It would be similar to that, but I don't believe the schools are interested in getting involved in this at this time.
I'm not talking about local. It was my understanding that something similar to what you were talking about was either linked to Asheboro City or Randolph County.
No, it's run through, I think it's run through their social services. Okay. But anyway, we're looking at that, and Mr. Honeycutt and I and other members of JCPC, we're going to be looking at that over the next year. And so hopefully we can come back to you with a good report. We're also looking at gang intervention. I mentioned earlier we do have a gang grant that's sponsored through JCPC, and Dwayne Harden is the lead person in that, and they're ready to roll with this. But we feel, and there's some other things here. We've been working closely with the health department. The Spanish-speaking community has been able to secure a Spanish-speaking therapist, and that's through Triumph and the United Community, which are private health providers. So I think there's a lot going on. There's an educator I think I could quote here, and I think I will say this. His name's Phil Schlechte. Our school system works with him some in training our administrators and teachers on maybe how to do things better, but he made a very poignant remark. If we're going to improve our schools, we have to improve our community. Well, it's vice versa on that too. Everybody's got to work together and show teamwork in getting things done. I think what we do in JCPC, I think that affects the schools in a positive way. I think what the schools do as far as their discipline is concerned affects the school, affects what JCPC does in a positive way. We all have to work together. And likewise with social services, our health department. So, do you have any questions?
I was in a meeting today, Steve, and one of the judges mentioned this day reporting center. And he opined that it would be nice if the county, the school system, the judges, the law enforcement here in the county all work together to make this happen. He was very excited about it.
Well, it does. The Day Reporting Center does have an education component. We could talk on that. And I know Dwayne developed a slideshow, and Linda, I think you saw that slideshow at Executive Oversight Committee, and Tim, you may have seen it at JCPC Committee, but it describes pretty much what we'd like to do, and it's very and we'd model it very much after what Randolph County is doing. Randolph County has one advantage over us, and is that it they combine their money with Montgomery County's, and they bring it all together. But that's the way they do business there. But anyway. If you look over the report, and Linda, I think somewhere there you're going to have to sign something on that report. And when Dwayne will get together, as I said, we just pulled that off the presses this afternoon.
Pat says we don't have it.
I'm not sure. I think he has to sign the plan. Oh, Steve just put this in my hands. This is this will need a signature. Looks like mine and yours, Linda.
Okay, that's no problem.
So
you'll just leave it right here. You're going to stay, or you want me to do it right
now? I'm not going to stay. I've got another. Yeah, I've got an appointment.
I'll do it. Get the pad.
Okay, I'll get the pad.
Yeah, you mail it back to you. Get that.
Okay.
Okay. Thanks, Steve.
Thanks very much.
Okay. Okay. Next is Mr. Albright. And maybe you can answer some questions here.
I'll do my best.
And now this is not a public hearing, but maybe you can just answer some
questions. I'm gonna tell you where we stand between the staffs and the three county attorneys. We've prepared local bills that will give the commissioners of all three counties the authority to answer some of the issues that you've heard tonight. First thing that I want to tell you is that Orange and Alamance have a bill that's slightly different than the Orange-Guilford version, because our staffs have worked.
Than the Orange-Guilford or Alamance-Guilford?
I'm sorry, Alamance-Guilford version, because our staffs have worked longer on the Orange side than we have on the Guilford side. Excuse me. In fact, we haven't had a joint working session with the Guilford staff yet. So. We haven't had a joint working session with the Guilford Alamance staff yet.
Sorry, will you repeat what you said about which one's different?
We've worked longer with Orange than
with Alamance and Orange
than Guilford and Alamance.
Okay, thank you.
The question was brought up tonight about instruments and papers that have been recorded. In the bills, all three versions of them, instruments and papers that are recorded can remain where they are now. You don't have to re-record. The legislature can deem that they're recorded in the appropriate county, so you're not going to have that expense. The biggest issue is taxes and how we're going to adjust taxes, and the bills address that. They divide it up into personal property and real property. The bills provide that property is taxed in a new county on and after July 1st, 2011. Except motor vehicles, which are handled differently. The county administrators, they can get together and address the difference in tax valuation. And in the Orange bill, there are two methods, the Alamance Orange bill. We can either use the sales assessment ratio compiled by the North Carolina Department of Revenue, or we can use the values established by the adjoining county tax administrators, and then they agree on what the new value is with the property owner. If they can't agree, then the property owner can go down to Raleigh and we'll get the Department of Revenue to make a decision. But I think we'll be able to reach some agreement between the parties. Some of the other issues that the bills address are unpaid tax liens and tax foreclosure cases. We have many of them ongoing right now in Alamance County. Those cases will be allowed to proceed just as if the property stayed in this county. It didn't change. The Alamance County, Orange County bill allows the county commissioners to waive the discovery process. Now, that's a process when you discover a new tax property. Based on the new survey, the commissioners can go back 5 years collect 5 years of back taxes, you can waive that under this bill. Right now, you can't. You're required by law to go back and discover property, which we felt was unfair. The criminal and civil actions that are in all three counties will continue in those counties and will not be abated. And after July 1st, 2011, if the bill is passed, any new criminal or civil actions based on the property location will be in the appropriate county. The Board of Elections of each adjoining county, if the bill passes, will be ordered to transfer voter registration records so that voters can be voting in the appropriate county. The jury commission of each adjoining county shall revise their lists by July 1, 2011. The Superior Court, District Court, and Prosecution Districts will be adjusted and transferred, but the areas affected by the resurvey of the county line won't affect the congressional districts, state house districts, or state senate districts, which will remain the same. Tax foreclosure and valuation cases, if you have any of those ongoing, and we do, they will be stayed until the issue is finally resolved, meaning that the process in Orange and Alamance, the petition process that I'll explain in just a minute, if it's ratified by both boards and a new map is sent down to Raleigh, and General Assembly will ratify the new map. The Board of Education, another important issue. All three bills talk about the Alamance, Orange, and Guilford Board of Education having authority to ensure that the transition is made that provides students and their siblings with a choice to remain in their current school districts until graduation from high school. Any child who's a resident of the area affected by this will have the choice to make, to stay in the same school system or to change. And that includes any children in the household that aren't in school yet, as long as they own the home. The only requirement is that notice must be given to the affected school systems by the parent or guardian. That's in the bill. Now, in Orange and Alamance, the staffs have been working on an administrative petition method. Guilford and Alamance haven't discussed this yet because our staffs haven't met. But in the bill from Alamance and Orange, we have discussed a petition method so that certain property owners within the buffer area will be allowed to petition whether to remain in the county they're in now or be moved. And if they meet the requirements that this board will have to approve. Now, remember, this bill, we're asking the legislature to give you the authority to do all these things. It doesn't establish the petition process. That'll be before you and before Orange in a separate meeting, if this bill is sent to Raleigh and is ultimately signed by the governor. So if that is done and the administrative reviews on the petitions take place, our staffs have come up with a number of, and this is just ballpark, of about 87 properties that may be involved in the Orange and Alamance line. Depending on what those folks decide, after the petition period ends, then the final surveys will be submitted and we'll go to Raleigh. We anticipate that'll happen sometime next May of 2011. The last thing I want to talk to you about is legislative immunity for county commissioners. Now, all 23 commissioners will, if the bill is signed into law, will have immunity from any liability under North Carolina law for taxes, failure to tax, school attendance, land use, elections, all of these other governmental functions as it relates to the location of the line. So what we have done in these bills, we're going to ask you to allow us to send these bills to Raleigh to give you the tools in a toolbox that you can use to address some of the concerns you've heard tonight. Guilford got ahead of the game a little bit. I understand they may have already sent theirs to Raleigh, I've been working with John Roberts in Orange County, and we're prepared, have prepared, and come up with a what we think is a good bill for Orange and Alamance, and we're just awaiting your permission to send it to the Legislative Drafting Committee. Now, I don't know what the Drafting Committee will do, but I hope that they'll cover all the points that we have asked them to cover in any proposed bill.
And this means, Clyde, that what we've talked about before for these people that's on the line, that they can survey their property and come into Alamance County, is that what you're saying?
For the Orange Alamance line, we have come up with a procedure, but we haven't, now the Orange Board hadn't approved it, folks haven't seen it, but from what we've heard from your direction right. on this, and working with the Orange County staff, we've come up with a procedure we think will work, okay. and we've tested it. Now, whether Guilford's going to agree to that is another question.
Well, that still shouldn't affect what we do in Orange County.
It shouldn't, but I mean, we should have all of these tools, in my opinion,
yeah.
to protect you as board members
exactly.
and give you some ability to address the concerns of the citizens.
What is the deadline to get this down to Raleigh to be written? It's 19?
Well, really, the sooner the better, since this is a short session, and they're tied up with budget issues.
It's cut off 19th, wasn't it?
They started last week.
Yeah, but they've got cutoff dates, too.
We have already, I understand from Mr. Roberts, the attorney for Orange, that he's already put a placeholder in there, so we don't have to worry about that.
Any more questions?
This doesn't, it's not absolute with this draft or with this bill that the county line, the geodetic line, would be moved. Is that correct?
No, it's not. This just gives you a bag of tools
right.
that if you're convinced that it should be moved, you have the authority to move. And it addresses the inequities of people whose property is going to be discovered. There's a line has been located now by the state of North Carolina. It's been located. So come January 1, tax bills have to go out unless we have local law that allows us to hold off and adjust these things.
So what you're saying, they'll be taxed in the respective counties until when?
They'll be taxed January 1 of 2011. And their children will have to go to school based on that geodetic line. If we do nothing.
Okay.
And that's why, from what I direction I've gotten from this board is to try and figure out a way to do something. So we've come up with this bill that I think covers all the problems that we're going to encounter, from voter registration to election board issues to congressional districts to schools and to the issue of taxation. And adjusting the tax rates, because ours is at one rate and
right.
Orange is a little higher. So,
a little my foot. You
said there were 87 properties involved here. Can you tell us generally where the majority of those are located?
The what now?
87 properties.
Bertie's probably could answer that.
That's just a number.
We got an updated number this week. It's more like 120 would have potential to do that. It's the 9th Street group, and
are they coming into Alamance County or?
They would have the option to petition because
yes.
some people, you know, believe it or not, some people want it to happen, vice versa. It gives everybody the opportunity to come in and petition the process. And Craig Bennett's here. He's here to observe from Orange County as well. That's part of the whole staff process that we did. And we're going to present that to you at a later time, but we can't do that until this bill is passed to give you this opportunity to do that. We have already set, you know, a presentation in its almost in its final form to show to you. We're ready to go on that.
Okay.
I think I'm hoping you'll be pleased. We had about 7 staff meetings about it, and up all the way up to upper management saw it, and so hopefully it'll be a good resolution.
I will say this, that the Orange County staff and the Alamance County staff are on a first name basis, and we work
sure.
well together, and we share information as we do with Guilford. We're trying to do our best to make this as easy a transition as possible.
Okay, do we need a motion on this?
I would say we do.
Yes, I'd like to.
Entertain a motion?
I'd like to move that we do send this to Raleigh and proceed, you know, to get this put in place.
I'd also like to ask you to include the Guilford resolution on that as well, and we'll attach our Guilford resolution, which.
Does it say the same thing?
It says everything except.
I hadn't seen it.
I hadn't either.
It's not included in your packet?
No, sir.
Okay, well, we'll start with the Orange, and I'll get you the Guilford one, and we'll talk about that, but it mirrors it.
Okay.
It does not say.
We don't have that.
The only thing that's missing is it doesn't adopt the geodetic line.
Okay.
The Alamance version.
All right, I have a motion on the floor.
Call for vote.
Here a second. I'll make that second.
Yeah, before we vote, is it open-ended enough to take care of people's problems within reason without moving the line? I know it sounds ambiguous, but I guess I'm just saying point blank, is it going to allow any grandfathering if we choose to allow it?
Well, if nobody petitions to have their property moved, the line will stay where it is. If they are found in a county, if they find themselves in a county where they don't want to be, It gives a tax collector some leeway, but it's not gonna help them if we don't move the line, because the line is where the state says it is. Until the state moves it, you're really bound to collect all the taxes within your county boundary by law. This transition period gives you enough time to address some of these issues.
We're out until July of 2011, right?
Right.
2011.
2011.
And Orange goes to, yes, 2011, that's right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Guilford's a little bit closer on the time.
Okay, I have a motion on the floor in a second. All in favor?
Can we have a discussion?
Sure.
Yes, I did.
So now you want to do the discussion?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, I have a motion in a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
Okay. Motion carries. Okay, next thing is the Pleasant Grove Modular Complex with Mr. Tim Berger.
And I want to say why I voted no, for the record. I voted no because I just don't believe academically we got all that we could be getting out of this process. We've got it partially addressed, and maybe 90% of it addressed, but we don't have the other 10. It's not academically as clean as it ought to be. That's just my personal opinion.
You missed it about 23 square miles. Ready?
Yes, sir.
Madam Chair, members of the board, good evening. You have before you a request to purchase a modular complex to serve as a community center for the Pleasant Grove area, to be located at what's been known as the Pleasant Grove Recreational Center. The county sent out requests for proposals for a modular unit. We had 7 bidders respond, with the lowest responsible bidder being M Space Holdings out of Garner, with the actual facility that would construct this modular unit would be Sunshine Manufacturing Structures out of Rockwell. Their bid was $111,997, which included the facility and the delivery and setup of it. I'd love to have a picture tonight of what it would look like, but it hasn't been built yet since y'all haven't approved to move forward with it. But I did want to bring a combination of maybe a couple things that will help you kind of maybe to be able to see what this would look like. This is actually the modular unit that is located at Pleasant Grove, our landfill. We spec this building out, the one for Pleasant Grove, to actually have a pitch roof, so it would give it more of a custom look to it. And it's going to have a pitch roof with a 6-inch overhang all around the building. Also, we have spec'd it out to have residential windows so that it'll give it more of a custom look. The exterior will be made out of actually what's 29-gauge high-rib steel, so it'll be very durable and very low maintenance. So that is the same material that they used on the Stokes County school units that I showed y'all previously. here's a floor plan that we had submitted with our request for proposal, and so this will, it'll be built very similar to this. The facility will include an exercise room and a lounge area. It will include three offices plus an additional area that can be used as a reception area and an office area also. It'll have a multi-purpose room, which will include a stove, refrigerator, ice maker, countertop, and all those kind of things, and plenty of cabinet space there. And it'll have two restrooms. The unit will have about, I think it's 2,115 square feet of conditioned air, of conditioned space inside the unit. So that should take care of the needs. This will be set on the property. If you can envision to the right here, the gym being to the right of this facility, with the highway being on the other side of the gym, but this will be located kind of behind the gym area, and so that's where it'll be set up at. So we're looking at that. There's a second part of this project. Of course, the first is actually purchasing this facility, setting it up, having it delivered and set it up, which is $111,997. The second part of that is actually doing purchasing ramps, steps, porches for the unit itself, which will be aluminum, grading out the area, putting in sidewalks, handicap parking, and also a contingency, which is the $37,003 that I had in there, which comes up to $150,000. When we did bring this matter to the board back in August of 2009, we did indicate that we anticipated that the project would be no more than $200,000. What we would like to do with the remaining $50,000 is to be able to use that on the renovations to the gym. We have sent out bids, received the bids back on the gym renovation project. If we can take that, whatever's left over that we do not use of the $200,000, be able to transfer that over with the insurance proceeds, we should be able to do the renovations to the gym that we need to do. Now, the gym renovation contract will be brought to you at your next meeting for you to approve. So we'll have some numbers on that project, and we would like to use the remainder of the $200,000 on that project if the board we'll so decide to do that. We anticipate that we should have this facility up and running within the next 90 days, if not much sooner, but we feel like a 90-day window is a comfortable period of time. So unless you have some questions, I'd like to ask you to approve for us to purchase this and to use the additional monies for the other things that need to be done to get the facility set up and to transfer the money over to use for the gym renovation project.
Is this bigger than the one at the landfill?
Yes, ma'am. The one landfill, I think the one landfill is about 1,500 square feet.
And it's this, very nice.
Yeah, it's very nice.
Anybody's not familiar, it's very nice.
It's well built. Yes. This will be about, like I said, about 2,115 square feet of conditioned space. Okay. So.
I did have one question on the LP package units. I noticed that this particular company doesn't have that listed, or... Is that all inclusive, or what?
Yes, that is included in the their base bid was the heating and air condition for the unit. Now, what we had some alternates, and I could go through and find it, but we had some alternate type ways they could bid the heating and air condition systems. And so, on your Exhibit A, you'll see where they did bid some alternates in there. The company that we're recommending for approval, they did not do any of the alternate bids, but they did include the HVAC system in their base bid.
What type of system?
If you can give me just 1 second, I can find that for you. It is four LP gas wall mounted units with AC properly sized for the building. So it'll be LP gas, and it'll be four units that'll actually be mounted on the exterior. They will not be ground units, they'll actually be mounted on the exterior of the building. So it'll be four of those LP gas units.
Okay. Who's the company again?
The company is M Space Holdings, which is out of Garner. The actual manufacturer of this is Sunshine Manufacturing Structures out of Rockwell, North Carolina, which is about an hour and a half south of here.
It'll be certified to be a modular?
Yes, sir. It'll be certified through the state. So it'll be inspected on their behalf. And then, of course, the plumbing and all of that will have to, exterior to the facility, have to be inspected by our county inspections on that.
Tim, could I ask you a question?
Yes, ma'am.
Several questions.
Okay.
What kind of condition is the gym currently in?
The gym is, of course, it's not usable now. But what we're going to be looking at doing with the gym is actually going in and putting a new heating system in there. The exterior, where they tore the wings off of it, will have to be redone on the exterior. There will be a new floor put in there. There will be, actually, the porch will part of it be closed in for a storage room. And trying to think, the wall that where one of the wings was taken off on the end, that's actually having to be restabilized with metal support structures inside of the gym. I think I may have hit all of them.
Electrical.
Electrical also. Electrical will have to be redone to accommodate the HVAC system, but plus just the lights for the gym also.
But the bathroom could be redone in the
bathrooms front. Bathrooms are not going to be redone at this time. And the reason being is when the initial bid came in, the low bidder on the project, it was higher than what we had insurance money plus this additional money to be able to do. So what we did is we went back and had them tell them what we wanted to pull out of the project so that we could get the things that we need to get done. In the future, we could look at going back and trying to do the restrooms at a later time.
So we won't have any at all in the gym?
Yes, they'll be there. They'll be the restrooms. We were looking at actually going and remodeling the restrooms entirely to make them handicap accessible.
So we'll still use the ones in the front, Brian? Is that the ones we're going to use?
Yes, they'll still be there and still be usable, yes. We just will not be able to renovate them at the restrooms at this time.
Okay.
So the $50,000 over, we hope, you hope.
Yes, ma'am, that we can carry over to the other project.
Exactly. That would take care of the gym.
Yes, ma'am, take care of the gyms. Just about everything we want to get done except for the renovation of the restrooms will be able to be redone. And we'd had originally having two windows put in to bring exterior light in, natural light in. We're just going to be able to do one window now instead of that, but it'll still work fine.
All right.
Any more?
No. Okay. Thank you so much.
We just need y'all to approve
that.
Do I hear a motion that we approve this request for proposals?
So moved.
Jim, got a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed?
Gotcha.
Mm-hmm. Next on our agenda is Sheriff Johnson, if you'll come forward, please.
Good evening, Commissioners. You know, for some time, I know the county has been struggling extremely hard to try to make ends meet with our current tax rate. And we've been called upon, the department heads of this county, several times by Mr. Honeycutt to make cuts. And we requested, first of all, do a 2% cut in our budget. And as sheriff, we looked at every way we could cut, and we come up with $278,385 for the 2% voluntary cut. Then again, he come back and asked that we cut 1%, at which time we stepped up to the plate again and we cut $164,000. Tonight, we were, over the past few months, we've been reviewing John Glenn's retirement, trying to figure out what we were going to do as far as a personnel officer with the Alamance County Sheriff's Department. And believe me, there's a lot of work that goes on over there with the number of employees we got. And we looked hard at Mr. Glenn's salary, which was $48,410.64. We also, at that time, was faced with the state retirement system where we were employing part-time deputies to do our courtroom security. And, folks, I'm telling you cannot pay for that type of careers that these individuals had to bring that expertise to our department. But we had to look at it hard, and we cut some of the salaries of those part-time positions, which left us with a total of $81,269 that hopefully we were looking at to turn back into the county. But after looking at redistributing the duties of John Glenn, we were only able to have $62,657.90 left. I was going to ask for a position, but I don't think at the time's right. I don't think we're going to. I think that as sheriff, I think I need to step up to the challenge that Mr. Honeycutt has given us, and I think we'll just have to do without that position this time. And I wanted to advise you folks that in all these things that we will be turning in, with the 2% cut, 1% cut, and the redistributing of the duties, $505,040 is what it will be to the county. And I want you to know this is in addition to the $18 million that we've brought in revenue from the Alamance County Jail. So in the future, and I understand you folks are up against the wall with our budget, but we're going to try to help where we can. We have some wonderful department heads in this county that has really bowed their back. And I don't envy you a bit. But like I say, we were going to talk about reestablishing a position, but we are not at this time.
Okay.
So thank you.
Well, thank you so
much. Thank you.
Appreciate all your work you've done. Thank you. Okay.
Sheriff, did you say that detention center brought in $18 million this year.
Yes, ma'am.
This
year. Last 4 years, $18
million. Last 4 years.
Last 4 years.
Last 4 years, beginning at the end of 2006, beginning of 2007 is what when we started holding federal inmates.
Okay. State. Thank you.
Okay. Next, we're going to go to number 9, which is Alamance Burlington Board of Education resolution for land purchase for Career Tech.
Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. In front of you is a resolution that is requesting the Board of Commissioners in accordance with North Carolina General Statute 115C-426F that any time that amount of money is spent for capital funding for property, it must be approved by the Board of Commissioners. And this is for the approval of 6.5 acres on 2618 North Church Street for the new Career Tech building that the schools are in the process of trying to build.
And also, is this a purchase price, $450,000?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I heard it was me.
Exactly, where is that? I know where the dog.
Right off McKinney.
I'm with the school system if you've got questions about that.
Where is it located?
It's located, if you know where the old East 70 Drive used to be, where the restaurant used to be, right there.
Right
beside that. That drive that goes right beside is where the land is. The house has got a sign for sale right now. It says Jay Wren. The house sits on that property, and then there's about 6.5 acres right behind the house.
All right, so as you go in the main drive for what used to be Winn-Dixie's to the left?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And the main drive that will go into the school site will come out. You'll have the entrance will be on Church Street, and then over on back where Andrews is at. Yeah.
What about the, just for information, behind Andrews there used to be a driving parking lot? Is that still there?
That's still there. And the county and the school system went in about 10 years ago. I think it's like a dollar lease a year for them to do the patrolling, the driving, the fire trucks, and training that. And that whole area is paved and fenced in.
Right. And who owns that property?
The Burlington School, or Alamance Burlington Schools owned it, and then we did a 10-year contract with Alamance County. So I would say that both own it.
Just curious, and so that property for the tech center backs, that's behind it.
If you've ever been to Andrews Elementary School, and when you're going down Buckingham, it backs into when you take a right where those two brick houses are, the land that goes where the trees start, that's where the entrance is.
Okay, I got you. All right, yeah. Our kids went to school at Andrews, so that's where they live.
Any other questions on this? Do I hear a motion that we accept this resolution?
So moved.
Is that a motion?
Second.
Have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. No opposed? That resolution carries. Okay, the next is the Alamance Burlington School System request for use of bond funds. Ms. Trinicott?
We have also received a request from the school system to spend money from the 2004 bond referendum. We currently have about a $3 million balance in that. This would be to spend $813,800 on the second floor at the Sellers Gun School Educational Center. And we need a motion to release those funds.
Any questions on this?
Is that in the original description of what the money will be used for?
No, sir. No, sir. This is leftover funding from those bonds.
I don't have any.
Do I hear move that we accept this request? Have a motion?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. No opposed. Okay. DSS, if you'll come forward.
Sure.
Thank you, Susan.
I have a budget amendment before you tonight. This is TANF Emergency Contingency Fund Allocation. This was a state grant from the federal government for Recovery Act that came to the state of North Carolina, 100% federal funds. The grant application was open to all 100 counties. 23 counties were awarded these grants. We were one of those counties. The total for this grant through September 30th is $56,000, but the allocation's coming quarterly, so this is for the first quarter. The purpose of this grant is to put folks to work. Specifically, it targets Work First recipients, and we are to put them in subsidized employment. We have six positions that are subsidized employment. One working with our grounds and maintenance crew at the Human Services Center, two scanning records at DSS, and then three with community agencies, the Salvation Army Boys and Girls Club and two at Positive Attitude Youth Center. And the real purpose of this is to get folks who were on Work First into the working world to build their resume and build their skills. And so we're real excited to have six folks that with this funding can go forward and build a resume to be hopefully employed. Already we've heard that one of the folks in one of these positions is being looked at as a permanent employee. So this is the first quarter of funding. We actually hear that this may be expanded past September 30th, and we would apply for some more going forward because it's been very positive for our Work First recipients, okay, who really need to build their resumes, their employment resumes.
Okay, any questions for
me? How's the money? I'm sorry, I'm sure you said it.
Coverage.
How's the money spent again? And all, you said six people here?
Six people in Alamance County. Mecklenburg asked for enough money for 500. But
six people. All right, tell me how that six people want to get the money, or who's going to get the money? Say it again.
It comes through the social services budget. We have the first allocation letter already. It's quarterly allocation. It's a reimbursement basis, and it's 100% federally funded out of the Recovery Act.
Where's the money go?
Where does the money go? We pay the recipient.
You actually give it to the recipient?
Yes, they're working.
So it's pay.
Subsidized pay.
Subsidized employment. It is pay.
And then what happens to them when it runs out?
Well, either they hopefully have been good employees and they're hired in vacant positions. There's also, we hear from the federal government, the possibility of carryover that we may be able to extend another year. So the position goes away. We actually don't have positions in DSS. We are working through a temp agency so that we don't have positions. When the money's gone, the folks are gone. But they've built their resume and they've got some positive job experience. And some coaching from these agencies that are all human service agencies in terms of their employment.
How are these six selected versus?
Well, they had to be Work First recipients and they were interviewed. They went through a screening at Manpower. Temporary agency, drug tested, and all those things.
And is Manpower actually controlling the employment process?
They are there? For the three that we have. The other three as well?
Yeah, they are for
all six of them.
So they're actually working through Manpower.
That's right, and they invoice the county.
And we're subsidizing
right.
As they work.
Right.
Okay.
With no county dollars, all federal funds.
Very good.
Okay, do I hear a motion to accept this budget? Have a motion?
Second.
A second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?
No.
Thank you.
Motion
Thank
carries. You. Okay, county manager's report.
It is budget time once again.
Budget.
Changed.
In front of you is the county manager's recommended budget for the upcoming year. Through our discussions, I guess, over the last month and a half from our initial workshop back in April and through all the meetings now, this is recommended budget that you do have that is one of a 52 cent tax rate. It does not include a tax increase. One of the other things that this budget does is we have looked very diligently to not use fund balance. We are using some, but not as much as it could have possibly been. As the sheriff mentioned earlier, I really want to thank the department heads here in the county. They've been asked to give, they've been asked to cut mid-year, they've been asked to cut beginning of the year, they've been asked to cut again. I appreciate their willingness to work with Amy and Susan and myself on this budget. We feel like we've got a livable budget. We've got a budget for this year, but as I'm gonna show, we also gotta start thinking about next year as well. So here's where we're at right now. Again, where we're at, changes from last meeting. Again, we're at 52 cent tax rate per 100 valuation. No tax increase.
We have some concern right now with the use of ADM funds. As you're aware, the school system has concerns about our request to use their ADM funds. It does have to be a joint resolution. We can use their ADM funds to help with our debt service. We're asking for them. It's not been agreed upon yet, but it is in the recommended budget that we're asking, and we're trying to get $1 million. It will require a match of 25%, which will increase our budget by $400,000. We will request $1.6 million in ADM funds. So that'll be a total of $2 million, but we'll get $1.6 million. We'll clear $1 million. The school board will get $600,000. So if they wanted to use some ADM funds for technology or anything else, they can use $600,000. So we felt like, and Amy and I said, that it was a fair balance. We would be paying for the match. We would get the benefit of the million, but they would also get $600,000 out of it. So we kind of think that's a fair way to look at it. Again, as we talked about at our last meeting, we went back and said, you know, asked our departments to cut even further. We received $211,000 in additional cuts. We have cut some places we have not originally looked at. We felt like it was fair to look at everybody, that I guess there was no sacred cows in the budget, that we looked at nonprofits, and we understand nonprofits are hurting just as bad as county government is as well, but we've asked to cut their budget by 2% as well. So if they're a 9% or a nonprofit, we're cutting their budget by 2%. That does include the LME as well, so they're included in the budget cuts. Again, as we talked about with ACC, we originally tried to increase their funding by $40,000 for the opening of the new culinary center, which would have been about a 10,000 square foot building. If you look at $4 a square foot a year for maintenance and insurance and upkeep, that would have been $40,000. Just couldn't do it this year. But we also cut them that $40,000. They asked for $80,000. We were going to give them $40,000. Then we had to cut the 40 out. Then we've cut them 2% off of this year's allocation as well to try to be equitable again across the board. One of the biggest cuts that we did receive, part of that 211 is from DSS. DSS cut an additional 1% of county allocation for an additional $100,000. So I do appreciate Susan and her staff for again going back and relooking at what they could cut. Budget revenues versus expenditures and fund balance uses. And again, this is general fund. Current expense projections is $130,752,420. Current revenue projections are $129,262,218. That will leave us using or needing fund balance to balance our budget of $1.49 million. But we have to back out some things from that because some things that we had to budget for are part of that fund balance. We had to add in the $400,000 for the ADM match. So that is part of that funding. So, but we will get that back. But we had to show that as a debit. You do not see in the budget the cost savings from the furlough days. The reasoning for that is under state statute, you must budget benefits fully. So even though we are going to have 5 furlough days, state retirement, 401k, I'm missing one, state retirement, 401k, they still have to be budgeted for fully. So, but you will see the savings from the furlough days, you know, within the departmental budget that'll be backed out. But again, the $1.49 million we're using does not include those savings. And again, when we back these figures out, we're really using less than $500,000 in fund balance.
Assuming the furlough days, right?
Yes, sir, with the furlough days. Counting the furlough days. Counting the furlough days.
What do we use this year, fund balance?
2.9. From where we started from to get to this point, to use less than a half million dollars in fund balance, what we're projecting, we've come a long way on this budget. Oh, come on in. Again, as we talked about last time, the sound effect worked this time.
Is that Gary Allred on there?
He hadn't got a hat on.
Yeah.
He just left.
We do have the big bear in the woods.
I'm sorry.
And I want you to make sure that we're fully aware of looking at next year. Again, we talked about earlier, the state's going to lose $2 billion in its American Recovery and Reinvestment Act. That money's going to come from somewhere. It's going to either come from schools more, or it's going to come from shifting responsibilities back to counties. We have used a lot of non-recurring revenue sources to balance this year's budget. As we talked about before, when we cut health premiums from $500 to $350, that saved us $1.5 million. We can't do that forever. You know, we've had some good years, but we feel like we can do that now. We may have to bump that up next year, but that's not a reoccurring revenue. The $1.7 million in interest from the school bonds, again, not a reoccurring revenue. That's a one-time shot that we're having this year. But we feel like now's the time to use it. ADM funds, again, not a reoccurring revenue. It's got to be a joint resolution by both the schools and the County Board of Commissioners. And again, we also have repayment of a loan to the Burlington, from the Burlington Alamance Airport of $1 million that is due in December.
Is that the last million?
Yes, ma'am. So our non-reoccurring revenue is $5.2 million. Like I said, we're okay this year. Next year, if we don't get the sales tax growth, if we don't get the investment growth, if we don't get the residential growth, we're going to be back in the same boat that we're in this year. We may be putting off some things this year, but we can make it this year. We've got a workable budget for this year. But I had to put it out here to make you aware of where we may be next year.
What was the overall growth of the economy in Alamance County and everything that we can, you know, that we're touching now? What do we think is going to end fiscal is through June? Have you any idea?
So you mean like what we're going to use in fund balance?
No. Growth of the, you know, tax base.
Economic growth.
Sales tax, so forth and so on.
Well, a lot of that's decreased.
What about property?
That decreased.
That was.
Overall.
Yeah. That was part of the revenue neutral loss.
Right, that decreased about $344 million, I think, total value.
Bound hill slide this year.
I'm talking about new properties. I'm talking about growth in our economy.
As you've seen from some of the monthly reports we get from inspections, we are starting to see an uptick, you know, and a strong uptick, you know. The problem that we have with that is when we've had double-digit losses the last couple of years is, you know, we're just trying to make up where we should be, you know, and then with the revow. So we are starting to see some growth. And again, you know, we didn't budget any sales tax increase on Tanker. We kept sales tax flat, even though we are starting to see an uptick on that. You know, so we're kind of hedging our bets a little bit for next year by keeping things flat, hoping things will increase for next year. But again, wanted to put this out there. Wanted to make sure everybody was fully aware in case the economy doesn't have the strong uptick. What's next? The biggest issue that's outstanding in this budget, unless the board has any other questions or concerns, is our ADM funds with the school board. So we're still trying to work those issues out. You've seen a letter that I've sent to Dr. Bridges last Friday, kind of outlining our concerns and our needs and why we were asking for the ADM money and where we were short on Article 40 and 42 in sales tax is supposed to cover their debt, which is not for the last 2 years, that causes us to dip into our fund balance. So,
when are they to vote?
I guess their next meeting is
next Monday. Is yeah. Next scheduled meeting.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, next Monday,
though. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So we, you know, I hope it, the letter. If not, we'll have to get the million from somewhere, and there's places
there's,
in the
there's
school.
Ways to get
there's
it.
Ways to get it.
I hope everybody understands that.
So, just putting it out there. But what we need from the board right now, again, you should have a copy of the manager's recommended budget. It will be online tomorrow. Hopefully by lunch tomorrow we'll have it online, but we would look for you to set a public hearing for June 7th, and then we would look at approval anytime June 7th towards June 30th.
Do we need to put a motion on that? I will make a motion that we do put that on our next.
Have a motion meeting. To set the public hearing for June the 7th.
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Any other questions on the budget?
No, I think you mentioned Tangier opening, and things are starting to improve slowly. Mm-hmm. I'm just hoping what's not going to happen is people from the crossing out here in the western part of the county or shop out here at Tangier, and you're just you're not going to see that much of a increase in sales tax. So we can be optimistically cautious.
Well, and again, we've kept sales tax this year flat. So we're not counting on really a lot of growth this year. Again, one of the things that you have in your budget is if we are starting to see the upturn, is that maybe look at January, relook at cost of living raises for employees. Again, this is the second year in a row that we've not recommended any increase for our employees, but we would like to maybe relook at that January to see where we are fiscally. If you remember, we did that this year and we had to cut $5 million. So it just kind of depends.
Well, one positive thing, though, is Holly Hill Mall, too, with Mr. Morton buying that. So that hopefully will give us a little bit of an.
And my children have been eating the fool out of Chick-fil-A at the new one since it's opened. So.
Yeah, we did have a ribbon cutting, and that was very good at the new Chick-fil-A. And they're going to give me a job if I don't get real licky. Anyway.
I just want to thank Craig and all of the department heads for the hard work y'all have done. I appreciate it. I know that it's been a tough year, and it may be tough next year, but you've worked through this thing and done a great job doing that, and I just appreciate the department head stepping up, the sheriff and
very much so. Very much so. It couldn't have been done without their willingness to and their understanding of the tough times that we're in. And again, we are going to look at different things. We're going to look at the early retirement once the budget is done. See if there's opportunities there to look at reducing workforce and reorganizing. So we're not done. This is a continual process.
So. But thank you for your hard work.
Thank you.
And all the department heads also. I'm seconding what he said. Okay. I'm not sure that was a motion, but I'm seconding. Amen.
Okay.
Y'all done great.
The next is consent agenda. Is there anything we need to pull?
I'm assuming on all these boards that the people you've got listed are the number that are needed. Is that correct?
Yeah, these right here. Yeah.
I mean, that's.
I think so. Is that
no
not right?
Questionable people on there, I guess, as far as.
I read them all. I didn't.
No, I'm not saying the person themselves, but the number of replacements and so forth.
Do I hear a motion then that we accept the consent agenda?
Yeah, quick.
I make the motion.
Okay, I'll second it.
Second. On favor?
Wow.
At this time. I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute, Section 143.318.11A4, to discuss matters relating to the location or expansion of industries or other businesses in Alamance County including agreement on a tentative list of economic development incentives that may be offered in negotiations.
Madam Chair, sorry to interrupt, but I don't think anybody's questions are right to go into closed session to discuss economic development. But I would like to know if anybody, either the commissioners, the county manager, and the clerk are going to be in closed session with you.
Can y'all answer that? I can't.
Mac Williams.
Mac Williams.
And what is the basis for Mr. Williams' presence?
He is the county's economic developer.
He is the county's economic development?
Okay. Do I hear a motion?
I make a motion. We'll go in closed session.
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
No.